Welcome to CTV News Trendline with Michael Stittle and Nick Nanos.
Nick, the federal Liberal government has released its budget with the promise of fairness for every generation. I'm curious, though, how it fits in with the issues that matter most to Canadian voters, and you've done some tracking on that.
Yeah, exactly. It's really interesting to look at in terms of, you know, a recent Bloomberg survey that we did on issues that will influence their vote in the next federal election, how this lines up. But you know what, Michael, I think what everybody's wondering is, I think one question has been answered. Is this an election budget? Yes. Like $50 billion in new spending. You know, Justin Trudeau campaigning, he did like, I don't know if we can say Dance of the Seven Veils, but anyways, he was campaigning leading up to the budget, saying all the good things that were there. You know, what's interesting is that in the survey that we did for Bloomberg News, cost of living was at the very top at 31%, followed by healthcare at 20, environment at 13, housing at 10, taxes at 10. So, you know, on the healthcare front, are the announcements on, you know, the pharmacare stuff, hardcore healthcare stuff? Probably not. You know, like the reality is if you don't have a doctor, this doesn't really help you very much. For those that are worried about the environment, there's the carbon tax, but nothing new there. Lots of talk about housing. But, you know, the kicker here is that when you look at that Bloomberg survey, more than half of Canadians identify issues that are economic issues as the most important. Cost of living, taxes, housing, the economy, all that kind of stuff. So, you know, what they want to see is not necessarily a progressive budget. They wanted to see something focused on dollars and cents and how people are going to pay for the bills. And housing, last time I checked, Michael, housing is not a federal responsibility. So they start to wade into this. I'm not sure how it's going to pan out.
So Nick, one of the big headlines out of the budget is Finance Minister Chrystia Freeland saying that she'll be increasing the capital gains tax on the top 0.13% of wealthiest Canadians. And just in the wider context of what you just said, do you think that will resonate with voters?
Well, it's very populist. This is populist style politics, except progressive populism. If you remember, Michael, we did the time machine back in 2015, Justin Trudeau, before he was elected, said the top 1% would pay more in order to pay for programs. Hey, now it's down to 0.13. So it's one little more than 0.1%. So, you know, what they're trying to do is to say that these taxes that are increases will not affect the vast majority of Canadians. But, you know, for those that are in the very top percentile, the big money makers, and who are looking at capital gains, say, for example, different types of market investments, they're going to be paying more, and that this will these proceeds will help pay for some of the stuff. But you know, any way you cut it, there's new spending, big deficits. It's not really a change from the past. It's kind of like, why don't we just say the liberal progressive agenda on steroids, except taking out of the equation the pandemic, which was unusual, but big spending. And maybe for the Liberals, maybe the one thing they're thinking about, and this will be my last point on this, Michael, is, hey, you know, let's spend more money. If we lose, it's somebody else's problem. If we win, we'll figure it out somehow.
Nick, there's a lot of palpable pessimism, I suppose you could say, especially among the youth of Canada, young voters. You've been doing some tracking on that sentiment as well. And what have you found?
Yeah, this is kind of like, I'll call it the Nanos polling therapy couch for citizens, right? We ask people what emotions they would use to describe how they feel about the government in Ottawa. Not the Liberals, right? Or not Justin Trudeau, just generally the government in Ottawa. There are like two positive things, anger and pessimism. Those are the two negative things. The two positive things are optimism and satisfaction. And then there's kind of disinterest, which is kind of in the middle. What we've seen is the anger quotient has hit a new record in our tracking on this. About 31% of Canadians say that would use words like anger to describe how they feel about the federal government. That's up a full 6 percentage points. And you know that anger quotient, Michael, if you're from the West, like Alberta, Saskatchewan, Manitoba, you are very angry. 45% of Canadians in those provinces would use the word anger. Pessimism is also significant. And, you know, the other thing is for young people, one of the things that we're seeing is that they're becoming more and more disinterested. It's kind of like they're unplugging because they're so upset about how things are. And, you know, disinterest nationally is around 11%. Among young people, it's 17%. But, you know, right now, only 21% of Canadians say that they're either satisfied or optimistic. Wow. More than 6 out of every 10 would use words like pessimism or anger to describe how they feel in terms of the government in Ottawa.
I mean, that's a huge challenge for the parties, you know, potentially going into a federal election, you know, in the coming year. I mean, how do you react to that, especially if you're the Liberal government and the budget that we've just seen or another major party?
So the big question is, this survey was done for Bloomberg before the federal budget, right? It was just released. Question is, does the budget really change anything? Like, you know, if you're anger and pessimistic, are the Liberals kind of like now Charlie Brown's teacher, kind of like wah, 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 where people are so angry and pessimistic, they just don't hear what they have to say. I think that's the challenge that the Liberals have. However, if you are the leader of the Conservative Party of Canada, you're trying to ride this wave of anger. Because do you know what? If people are angry, you don't have to worry about calling them to remind them to vote, because they're angry. They'll get out and they will get out and want to punish the incumbent government of the day. So for Pierre Poilievre, the leader of the Conservative Party, you know, he's probably looking at numbers like this and thinking, how can we stoke the anger? How can we stoke the pessimism in order to create the conditions for an election that's based on time for a change, at least if you're the Conservatives? And then if you're the Liberals, you probably want to say, this is a bad time for change. Or the other change is not good change. And that's probably going to be the main battleground. But these feelings really give a sense of how people are, where people are at right now when it comes to the government in Ottawa.
On that note, what's the latest with your ballot tracking? How many Canadians are looking for change?
Well, still good news for the Conservatives. They're at 40% in majority territory. Liberals back 16 points at 24. New Democrats at 21. Bloc at 9, which is a good number because that 9 converts into the high 30s in Quebec. So that's still great for the Bloc Québécois. Green Party at 4. People's Party at 2. So 16-point advantage for the Conservatives over the Liberals. You know, that Liberal number of 24%, when we look at the long-term trend line, is near a low that we haven't seen for quite a long time for the Liberals. And that 40 percentage point mark is nearer a high for the Conservatives, and much higher than it was, you know, back in 2015 under Stephen Harper. So those Conservative numbers are better, comparable or better than under Stephen Harper, the tail end of his mandate. And those Liberal numbers are, it's kind of like back to the future, maybe, kind of, you know, the numbers that Justin Trudeau inherited when he became leader of the Liberals a decade ago.
It'll be interesting to see if the federal budget turns the dial on that. But I'm also curious about how close the Liberals and the NDP are in this.
Yeah, it's really cool. Actually, Michael, when we look at the trend line, now I'm just looking at the interaction between the Liberals and the New Democrats. So, you know, the Liberals picked up a little bit, NDP went down. Now the Liberals went down, the NDP went up. That's going to be the key thing to watch. And, you know, when people are right now are drifting away from the Liberals, for those that are still with the Liberals at this particular point in time, it looks like they're mostly looking at the New Democrats. But, you know, any way you cut it, right now, the Conservatives are in the driver's seat. They're in majority territory. And how about this for something? What happens if after the budget, our tracking shows that the Liberal numbers don't go up? Like, they've been in election mode with Justin Trudeau basically announcing goodies leading up to the budget, spending in the budget to try to move the numbers. If the Liberal numbers don't move up after this, perhaps the lesson for the Liberals will be spending is not the solution, political solution, for them to break this trend line. It'll have to be something else.
Nick, before we move on, I just want to zoom in on Quebec a little bit. I do see a little bump in support for the Bloc. What's driving that? Is that part of a bigger trend there?
Well, there's two things happening. First of all, not only is the Bloc doing better in the province of Quebec, but also the Parti Québécois provincially they're doing better in the province of Quebec. And I think a lot of this, you know, what we're seeing at least is soft numbers actually in Quebec for both the Conservatives and the New Democrats. And the Bloc benefiting from that. Liberals not as strong, but still obviously, you know, Quebec is really, the battle for Quebec is really about the Bloc Québécois and the Liberals for all intents and purposes. You know, for the Conservatives, they don't really need Quebec to form a majority government. It's kind of like the Harper franchise when he won his majority mandate. But, you know, for the Conservatives, they want to hold on to as many of those seats as they can in Quebec. But even if they lose a couple, they'll be picking up seats in Atlantic Canada and Ontario, even a couple in the West, and probably a few in British Columbia.
Nick, we're going to take a quick break, but when we come back, we'll take a look at which party leader Canadians would prefer to be their prime minister. Nick, obviously the federal Conservatives have a pretty big lead on the Liberals, and it's always interesting to see how the party leaders are doing as well. In your latest preferred PM numbers, what are you seeing?
Well, we talked about the ballot numbers. Look, the Conservatives ahead by a whopping 16 points. On the preferred prime minister front, Pierre Poilievre's ahead by 14 points. So still, you know, he's at 34. Justin Trudeau's at 20. Jagmeet Singh is at 17. So, you know, Pierre Poilievre and the conservative leader is still doing exceptionally well. The other thing is when you look at that 34 number, that's basically like a 10-year high when you look at the 10-year trend line for the conservative leader. So by any measure, the Conservatives are doing well right now and at record highs, like better than it has been in over a decade in terms of both ballot support and leadership. And, you know, the kicker here, Michael, is we know a lot of voters don't vote based on party loyalty because fewer voters are loyal to any party. Many times they don't vote on policy because they don't trust anybody and they're cynical in terms of any campaign promise being delivered. They vote based on leader. And right now, at least, the Conservative leader is clearly in the driver's seat compared to the Liberal leader.
Poilievre has really been hitting the Liberals over the cost of living crisis. And we just saw the federal government release its budget in part to tackle that. I want you to listen to this back and forth, Nick, in the House between Pierre Poilievre and Finance Minister Chrystia Freeland.
Conservatives will vote against this wasteful inflationary budget that is like a pyromaniac spraying gas on the inflationary fire that he lit. It is getting too hot and too expensive for Canadians.
I think that it is high time for the opposition, which poses as being on the side of working people, to clarify its position today. Will the opposition join us in asking those at the very top to pay a little bit more to support Canadians, or are they going to show their true colors?
Well, Nick, what do you make of that?
Do you hear me laughing? Like, I'm laughing, Michael. It's pyromaniac versus poser, right? Like Poilievre saying, you know, the Liberals are like pyromaniacs in terms of their spending. And Chrystia Freeland, the Minister of Finance, saying that the Conservatives are posing. And, you know, that's very Victorian, I just like to say, kind of in terms of the allegory there. But posing, the Conservatives are posing in terms of being on the side of working people. But this basically shows us the key battleground. You know, Pierre Poilievre, love or hate the guy, you know, he's king of the clip. Why don't we just say that straight out? Like, you know, he says stuff, it's snappy, it's catchy. It kind of, you know, what people remember is pyromaniac. And I thought of, you remember that song in the 1980s, like Burning Down the House by Talking Heads? Mm-hmm. That's probably what Pierre Poilievre, although that's probably a little ahead of his time. He's probably, I don't know, in high school or, I don't know, middle school or something like that, because he's mm-hmm. Younger fella. You know, it's just this whole idea from his perspective is that this spending is not the solution. And I think that's basically the key message from the conservatives, and that the this big spending budget will create even more inflation. Like, you know, the thing is if you're the governor of the Bank of Canada and you see $50 billion in new spending, you have to be wondering whether what the impact might be on the economy. And whether this is inflationary or not. So, you know, the reality is the governor of the Bank of Canada will render judgment on whether whether he feels that this is good or bad for the economy, and it might have an impact on interest rates. And, you know, but the key thing here in that exchange is both of the parties are fighting for working Canadians. That's basically what it comes down to. And we have two competing visions for that. For the Liberals, it's about putting government support into their hands and creating social programs to support Canadians. For the Conservatives, it's very different. It's about reducing the size of government, reducing taxes, and you know, using that approach in order to help Canadians. It's not, I guess, if you're Pierre Poilievre, government is not the solution. If you're the Liberals, government is the solution. And that's probably how they're going to duke it out come the next federal election.
Nick, I think we'll leave it there. As always, thanks very much.
That was fun.